Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week it's our September special subject, Stanley Cavell's Pursuits of Happiness. We'll begin by discussing the book itself, and we will have three in-depth discussions about movies covered in the book, The Awful Truth, His Girl Friday, and Adam's Rib. And we'll be casually alluding to the other four films that have chapters in the book, no doubt. So be prepared for a wild and woolly discussion today. Elise, you want to set the stage for us with Stanley Cavell's Pursuits of Happiness. When was the book written? Who is Stanley Cavell?
Well, the book was published in 1981.
It collects some essays that had been written for publication prior to that date, right? And then he added more to flesh out the
design or the theory?
Very idiosyncratic, self-defined microgenre.
Yeah, I mean, this hasn't really been widely picked up as a genre. People don't think of the comedy of remarriage particularly as Cavell defines it, the way they think of the romantic comedy or the screwball comedy, even.
No, and I think that's going to be a big part of our macro discussion about Cavell. You know, what is he doing here? Is it something that is repeatable? Can others do this kind of thing? Or is it really particular to him? Is it an approach that can serve other film scholars?
And does that matter?
Oh, well. Well, I don't think it matters either way.
Okay, spoilers. Dave doesn't think it matters.
So who is Stanley Cavell?
I thought I would frame that more in terms of our own encounters with Stanley Cavell, because I think we would have different areas of focus with him, even though we have this book in common. But just to give you the Wikipedia first paragraph summary, Cavell was the Walter M. Cabot Professor of Aesthetics and the General Theory of Value at Harvard University. I always liked that idea, the theory of value. It's unfortunately nothing that came up in my own undergraduate philosophy education. He very much concentrated in his writings on the works of Wittgenstein, J.L. Austin, both of them considered, although in vastly different ways, ordinary language philosophers.
Or weirdo analytic philosophers.
Yeah, not in the main line of, you know, Bertrand Russell analytic philosophy, Anglo-American analytic philosophy, as well as American thinkers like Emerson and Thoreau, who are brought up in Pursuits of Happiness. He likes to do a lot of thinking about America, which is relevant to this book, beginning with the title. I read this book, I would say, in probably 1995, and it was the first real work of film criticism I'd ever read. I must have been introduced to it by the filmmakers and film professors I was hanging out with at the time. It was very much in the mid-90s, it was very much a book with buzz, still, despite being published in 1981. A kind of, here's this awesome, crazy book. If you love to think and you love old movies, you're gonna like this book. Read it. Tell me about your encounter with Cavell before I go on.
Well, I was doing a lot of work in the mid-90s, mid to late 90s, in history departments, later English department, on film. I was focused on Capra at the time, and I had read Elizabeth Kendall's book. That was probably the first sustained critical engagement with romantic comedy that I encountered.
As soon as you say that, I remember, I'm pretty sure I read Molly Haskell's From Reverence to Right before I read this.
Yeah, but that's not focused on romantic comedy particularly.
No, but she does talk a lot about romantic comedy in it, as well as The Woman's Picture, which Cavell has another collection of essays about.
Yeah, we'll probably do that at some point for a special subject, Contesting Tears. I encountered Cavell around the same time as Ray Carney, who wrote American Vision about Frank Capra. It happened one night.
Mm.
That's why I read the book. But of course, I stayed for the other chapters and found a lot of interesting stuff in all of them. They were all movies I had seen before. Most of them I had seen probably 15 or 20 times already by then, and have seen at least that many times since then.
I feel like I must have seen most of these movies, maybe not Adam's Rib, by the time I read the book as well.
So just to give everyone the order in which which they're presented. They're not chronological. It actually starts with the Lady Eve after an extended introduction called Words for a Conversation. Then it goes back to It Happened One Night, founding member of the screwball comedy genre in traditional parlance anyway. Bringing Up Baby is the third chapter, Philadelphia Story the fourth, His Girl Friday the fifth, Courting of Marriage, Adam's Rib is the sixth, seventh chapter is The Awful Truth. At the time, and even more since then, and when thinking about how we were going to approach this episode, honestly, I feel like the only one that really makes any sense is The Awful Truth. Like, most of his insights are derived from The Awful Truth, and then he does crazy idiosyncratic stuff to make the others fit with what he wants to do, and it's great. Like, that's part of the genius of the book, and the readability of it, and the ways in which it just gets Emersonian and refuses to treat a genre in a consistent way. He basically says, most of the films that I'm talking about don't have a set of characteristics that genre members should have.
Of course, once you get into genre theory, you realize that almost no genres have that. Film genres, such as the questionable film noir genre, right?
Yeah, but this is well beyond that, because it's so specific. It's the comedy of remarriage, and a lot of them don't even have remarriage in them.
Right.
But he says, in good Emersonian fashion again, I mean, he finds compensating themes in various entries that he wants to put in there, and he says that makes up for it.
Yeah, I just do want to emphasize that if you've ever taken a course in genre, the first thing you'll be taught in that course is we don't know what a genre is. It's not science.
No, it's not science.
Hey, if you take a science course and you have to learn what genera are, I mean, no classification is science. You don't actually take science courses in that. You take philosophy of science courses in that.
Taxonomy is famously unstable. We have learned in our own lifetimes that birds are dinosaurs. That wasn't the case definitively when I started reading about dinosaurs in the 70s.
But this gets into territory that's not just unstable the way all taxonomy is unstable, all classification, but into territory of perverseness.
I think it just has to be said from the beginning that these are just seven movies Stanley Cavell loves, and he wanted to talk about all of them.
True, but it's not sufficient to say that, because you also have to think about what does he see in this set of movies in particular that makes him want to think about marriage, makes him think that they can sustain thought about marriage that he wants to do in this book.
Marriage and the new woman, quote unquote.
And a few other things, but they're all under the rubric of, I would say, marriage and America for him.
Maybe not in 1981, I'm not exactly sure, but by the end of his career, and he kept going until his death, basically. He was working with Sack Van Berkovich at Harvard in an American studies milieu, interdisciplinary approach to understanding the meaning of America writ large, which, you know, has some national egocentrism built into it. But on the other hand,
yeah, people have also attempted to think, what is the meaning of Canada? Nobody cares, but
that's the thing. I think it does take on greater importance when you're dealing with America, because the whole world is under the booted heel of America. Having people trying to understand it is valuable, even outside the borders of that country.
Before we go on to try to define what Cavell has to say here about marriage in America and why he wants to do it using this set of films, I'll talk a little bit more about my experience of the book as a way of getting into that. So I had been reading literary criticism since I was 13 or 14, and literary theory, not French theory, never heard of that, literary criticism and theory, and theater criticism and theory. Just as a kid going to the library, I've stumbled on it completely by accident and discovered I liked reading it as much as I liked reading fiction. By the time I was 17, I had tackled some pretty considerable books in size and scope, like Camille Paglia's Sexual Personae, and I also started taking an interest in classical Hollywood cinema, and I read a lot about the movies, but I just read those books that were in the movies section of the library, which were not Pursuits of Happiness.
No.
You know, they had all the pictures, kind of like the books we read from for our Studios Year by Year series. They had a bunch of pictures, they had a bunch of descriptions, they talked about the stars a little bit.
Some vague evaluations at times.
I knew about Pauline Kael, but she wasn't writing about practically any movies that I was interested in at the time.
No, just Citizen Kane, Brian De Palma.
So when you read this extended intro that Cavell does, like, one of his big projects here is that he's shocking himself a little bit by daring to bring the great minds, particularly the European minds, the great Western thinkers, in conjunction with these romantic comedies. You know, you want to bring them in conjunction with Bergman, maybe that's okay, it's not quite as crazy, but if you want to apply that kind of thought, or even try to make an equivalence in quality between the thinking that these films are doing and the great philosophers, like that's getting a little bit crazy. This is the kind of conversation that he wants to be able to create about not just film, but American film in particular, and again, Hollywood film. And so I remember reading the book, and one of the things it certainly did for me was to, well, Cavell talks about it specifically in terms of taking an interest in your own experience, which he says he gets from Emerson and Thoreau. This is what he learns from the American Transcendentalists. Putting that kind of philosophy into practice here by saying, it seems to me that my experience of these films is worth talking about in this way.
This is absolutely the insight that the Transcendentalists did contribute to the world, that even the most idiosyncratic aperçu of a fact can lead to something that could be potentially universal or beneficial to all humankind.
And I'd already gotten started down that path with Oscar Wilde, The Critic as Artist, and some of his other critical writings, where he talks in the same terms about taking an interest in your inner life and not minding about the narcissism of that. In fact, that kind of egotism, when performed by a thoughtful, intelligent person, anyway.
It's not as siloed off as it might initially appear to be. It can take you far enough beneath the ground, beneath the superficial psyche, into something that is at the root of all human consciousness, or any. Anyway, that's the idea.
The Emersonian spin on that, how Emerson sees himself as getting out of narcissism, which Wilde isn't as interested in, although he definitely read Emerson. Wilde just sees that as the good life itself.
Well, yeah, of course.
To take an interest in your own experience is to...
Well, it's the examined life. I mean, that goes back to Socrates.
It's to create soul. Yeah, of course. Self-knowledge and all of that. But these are just new ways in which to iterate this. And this is the basis that Cavell wants to use for film criticism, as a way of having the courage to, I mean, defy the canon, I guess, a little bit. Because he doesn't want only certain films to be talked about in only certain ways. He wants to know how much thought they can sustain and how much thought they are actually doing. He doesn't mind, as he explicitly brings up, he doesn't mind that that may sometimes produce overreading. He says, in fact, we're probably more often in danger of underreading.
Yeah.
So I can definitely trace a line from Oscar Wilde through this book to not just my approach to criticism, which I've done in various ways, writing essays for university, to writing essays that have been published online, to this podcast, obviously, that my approach to criticism is always informed, always has those thoughts at the back of my mind. The second thing that was going on when I was reading this book is I'd just gotten married.
And you were looking forward to getting remarried.
And I had gotten married because I had found a person that I thought that I could converse with for the rest of my life, a meeting of minds. And that was another aspect of my, besides my love of film, and the love of film that my husband and I shared, that was another aspect of my experience that I was taking an interest in. And so I was fascinated by the way that Cavell talks about marriage in this movie. He thinks that these films are philosophizing marriage, and he's trying to find a way to both theorize and idealize marriage. So, for example, if you contrast this with a recent book, Janine Basinger's I Do and I Don't, which is talking about how Hollywood, mostly from the studio era up to the 1960s, movies have presented marriage. Well, that's a book that's probably guilty of under-theorizing marriage, because it's kind of just one example after another, right? Without trying to think about how these movies or groups of these movies are thinking about marriage. But also, there's absolutely no attempt in the book to idealize marriage in the way that Cavell does here. It's a beautiful poem to marriage, this book, but a particular kind of marriage that's going to appeal to intellectuals. But intellectuals who like romantic comedies.
Well, he's looking at them as transhistorical documents, but also as documents embedded in a particular time and place, America in the 30s and into the 40s, where they are cultural interventions. This was not the common understanding of what marriage was, and I don't suppose it is today either, although it might be closer to that now. The idea that marriage is supposed to be an intellectually stimulating
festival,
rejuvenating, return to the wellspring of youth, leavened with the wisdom of age, or the wisdom of adulthood, and carnal knowledge.
I was 19, almost 20 when I got married, so I was quite at a transitional age, and I remember reading this book and thinking to myself, I almost feel about my marriage the way that Cavell writes about it in this book. Almost. Really, really close. But my relationship with my best friend, this nails it.
Okay.
It's a marriage for intellectuals, so it has that quality, but it also has playfulness.
It may be transferable to other modes of being, but it's very pointedly a heterosexualist.
Oh, God, yes.
Narrative, and it does not theorize non-romantic friendship or romance between people of the same gender at all. It's really laser-focused on relationships between a man and a woman who are married.
But I can remember the passages that I was thinking of when I was thinking that, and they were ones like talking about in the It Happened One Night essay, what this pair does together is less important than the fact that they do whatever it is together, that they know how to spend time together, even that they would rather waste time together than do anything else, except that no time they are together could be wasted. I was like, yes! That's how I've spent the last 4 years with my best friend, and let's hope my marriage is eventually this good. Reader, it wasn't.
Really is a theory of marriage as friendship, but it certainly doesn't leave out the erotic.
And yeah, if you want to, I think you certainly can apply his thoughts to marriage, to non-heterosexual relationships.
Yeah, you can, of course, but he doesn't.
And non-heteronormative relationships, but then you're going to have to scrape off a lot of excrescences. There's a lot of questionable heterosexist stuff in this book that even at the time I was like, I don't know how I feel about this. The man's claim that he has to make on the woman, for example, that seems to have something to do with asserting his masculinity. The fact that he has to educate the woman, create the new woman. Now, these are all really interesting concepts, some of which have some applicability to some of these movies, but they're more interesting to think about in their own right than anything that is clearly to be derived from the movies themselves. But to go back to the question of what about these films leads him to theorize America, well, he goes into that very specifically in the intro when he talks about the similarities and differences they have from Shakespearean comedy and stage comedy derived from the Shakespearean model. Although he does say, leaning on Northrop Frye here, he does say that not much stage comedy is derived from the Shakespearean model, but that nevertheless, even though he thinks these movies, most of them, he makes an exception for His Girl Friday, he thinks that these movies do have more in common with Shakespearean romance than they do with other romantic comedies. And you have to look at the American screen and the fact that these movies are in America at this time period with these stars makes them obviously different from Shakespearean comedy as well. I think this was the first time I had ever thought about what makes American film, and can we theorize this the way we might theorize Shakespearean or Elizabethan or Roman comedy?
One thing that he does that puts him in the company of Elizabeth Kendall is that he focuses primarily on the woman and her role and her development, which takes place over the course of each of the films. That's the primary emphasis.
Right, that's his creation of the woman idea. However you may feel about that as an idea.
That part of it, I think, is debatable, but what you can't argue is that even though these films have great male stars in them as well, for the most part,
and Cavell loves to celebrate them, particularly Cary Grant,
it is still, Cavell and Kendall agree, that the thing that sets these movies apart is the primacy of the female role in each of them.
Even though he feels dubious about some of these actresses.
I mean, he's less celebratory in general than Kendall is.
He's expressed dubiousness about whether Claudette Colbert or Irene Dunne can sustain this kind of interest.
I think he's just playing devil's advocate there, because he clearly thinks they can.
So even if we were, and I think we actually brought this up, because we have brought this book up in the past when we're doing doing
lots of different things.
Lots of different things, particularly Hollywood romantic comedies. Even if you just want to talk about these films as theorizing and idealizing marriage as this ongoing, joyous, and yet rigorous philosophical conversation that is also a bid between the two. And yes, it is important for Cavell that it's a man and a woman for equality. Even if you think of marriage that way, even if you say that that for him and not the feature of remarriage, which we haven't even gotten to yet, we better get to that next. No matter what you single out as what is the essence of his idea of the comedy of remarriage, it doesn't fit all of these movies.
Not even close.
Because when we talked about The Lady Eve, you were like, how is this a movie about an intellectual conversation between an equal pair? It's not. It's not at all.
It really isn't.
Not remotely. It's anything but that. And yet, of course, Cavell talks about it in a very interesting way.
Oh yeah, the chapter is interesting. I still feel like it doesn't belong in this book at all.
Well, I'm not even sure how the creation of the woman, like how he even derives that from The Lady Eve.
There he's leaning so heavily on the Miranda Prospero sort of link. It really is his way of getting as in-depth as he's ever going to about the relationship between the new woman and a father figure who is supportive of her development.
True, but that doesn't even turn out... I mean, of course, he always has his Freudian excuse, you know, how Freud is like, well, if there's the absence of something, then it's because there's this other thing that's covering up for it.
Yeah.
He always has his excuse to say, well, if that's not present in any of these other films, then there's this other compensating feature, which, by the way, you could think of him as not actually being this delusional Cavell, but as just kind of creating this playful edifice. Because if you do think of the different features in these movies as compensatory for each other, so different tropes as kind of being in conversation with each other, that becomes a very interesting way to think about them.
Yeah, I don't think he's delusional. I think this is a gambit on his part that works. The book is a tremendous joy to read from beginning to end, and the fact that you disagree maybe with his assertions about the relationships, the family resemblances between some of these movies does not tarnish the book. It actually enhances it. The thing that I thought about the most this time, he ends the book with the awful truth, and that is the most intellectually honest, fair play type of thing that he's done in the whole structure, because that's where you get almost all of the core concepts that you need to understand what he's trying to get at when he's talking about the comedy of remarriage. And there's no other reason for it to be at the end other than it is the pièce de résistance, the test case for him. It's not in chronological order in any way. He doesn't really give any other reason for it other than you just have to assume, okay, this makes sense. He's ending it here because this is the one that really is the comedy of remarriage with all of the features that he talks about that should be there or need to be compensated for.
So before we go on, I should say that, Dave, I don't think, but God knows, because we've talked about a lot of different things on the podcast. I don't think we've ever brought this up on the podcast, but in private conversation, something you said to me has really resonated, and I can bring it up as a way that you could still have this bid for equality between the man and the woman that Cavell thinks is essential to this genre, or to his concept of marriage. Expand that beyond the heteronormative idea, which is to say to me that any two people, no matter how close they are to each other in thought, as we're very close to each other in thought, that's why we can converse richly, are so vastly different from each other that you don't have to even worry about or think about gender differences ever.
No, not really.
They aren't necessary. Gender is not a necessary difference in any relationship.
Here's one thing, though, that does make it a little bit more universal, unless you start getting into polyamory. That doesn't really fit with Cavell's vision of romance, but a key aspect of all the marriages that are examined here, no children.
Oh yeah, we should bring that up. Okay, that's very important. And at some point in the book, what essay is it in? It's either in Adam's Rib or The Awful Truth, where he says that the way marriage is defined in this genre, it's justified by neither the law nor the family. So that's one way to look at it, that, yeah, marriage for him has to have this democratic conversation between equal and different people, bidding for acknowledgement and equality, and particularly the woman, because her equality is in question, or it's not marriage according to this genre.
And their one-to-one relationship has to be self-justifying. It can't be, oh, well, we've got to get remarried for the kids. Or
true, but also it's just that, I really think it's just that he refuses to define marriage as we are raising children together. But it is marriage. It's not just a relationship. Because elsewhere, he will talk about, and this is definitely in The Awful Truth, the diurnal aspect of marriage. The fact that it has this familiarity. It's a person that you live with carnally, whatever that means for you, every day for years and years and years.
When he talks about how pets do appear from time to time as very important companions, especially The Awful Truth, but they're alluded to more than shown in Adam's Rib as well, the dogs. I mean, they become very important at the end of the movie where they're contemplating going back to the cottage and seeing the dogs. But again, that is as important as Mr. Smith, the dog, is in The Awful Truth. He's also there to kind of emphasize the fact that this couple has chosen not to have kids.
But you don't have to say that, you know, if you have kids, you cannot subscribe to this definition of marriage. It just has to be something that happens in addition to your having children. Your marriage is not your having children, is not your raising the children. Your marriage is the carnal and intellectual conversation with all of your being that goes on between you and the other person.
Oh yeah, and I think he actually says that somewhere, right? He's not saying that this marriage can't have kids, but for the purposes of storytelling, it would distract from what he wants the films to focus on if there were kids involved, because that would pull the narrative in. Because all of these narratives, as different as they are, they're pretty laser focused on the relationship between the man and the woman in question.
Yeah, the people figuring out this relationship and figuring out the problems inherent to equal sexual relationships.
And there, the Lady Eve does fit, because even though Henry Fonda doesn't even know who Barbara Stanwyck is a lot of the time and can't tell that she's the same person, it's still all about the way they interact.
And bringing up baby, I think, is all about the playfulness aspect.
Bringing up baby fits, I think, even though there's certainly no remarriage in it.
And there's no philosophical conversation between, there's no deep conversation between them.
Well, in some ways there is, but a very distracted variant of it.
But it's about the fun that they have together and the problems with that. Like, that's where he gets the most Freudian in that essay, where he's talking about, well, why is it that the man, you know, all of this playfulness is a stand-in, and I think this is right, although the first time I read that essay I thought he was insane, talking about there being sexual allusions throughout Bringing Up Baby, and now every time I watch it I'm just like, yeah, of course there are.
I think this one belongs in the tale.
You tried it there yesterday. So this whole relationship between them and everything they're doing in the movie is just displaced, latent sexuality. And the play that they're doing, the games that they do, are a displaced version of sexuality. But then why does the man not know that he's enjoying it the whole time until the end and have such trouble figuring that out? Why is it so painful for him? And I mean, that is something the movie is, in its way, reflecting, the comedy of the movie is reflecting on some problem, and I can't tell you right now exactly how to answer that question, but some problem in human sexual relationships, as is The Awful Truth, where he does really get in depth into how the movie defines and works through that problem. So we will be talking in depth, obviously, about The Awful Truth, but before we do any of that, we should probably just talk about the feature of remarriage and what that means for a minute. So first of all, as he points out, these movies did not invent a comedy in which two divorced people figure out they're still in love and get remarried. That may have been, at least in 20th century memory, Noel Coward in Private Lives. But he's right, of course, that that movie is a very, very dark satire. There's a kind of marriage in that movie that might be attractive. It's definitely not the kind of marriage that he's talking about in this book. Not that kind of whole-souled conversation.
Yeah, because the route back to a deepened version of the marriage, whether it's a legal remarriage or a spiritual remarriage, it's through a shared journey back to childhood, back to the roots of personality, and to a pre-adult sense of jouissance that nevertheless has an experienced 30-something person.
Which these movies differ from traditional romantic comedies, stage romantic comedies, in that they aren't focused on young people who are getting married for the first time. These people are getting remarried because they already have this marriage experience, this sexual experience.
Or they they've been leading a life that has not put them on the track for marriage, and they're now into their 30s for some other reason, right? Like some of these professional men, Clark Gable as a reporter who's obviously never had time for marriage, or Cary Grant as a paleontologist who's obviously spent his 20s in grad school and trying to these bones.
I mean, you can say that of all of the romantic comedies made in this period, because none of the great romantic comedies are made by ingenues and juvenile characters. A Dickens novel, you might get a young romantic pair who are pretty damn boring and not at all the focus of a novel, but nevertheless they need to get married by the end of the novel, while the novel focuses somewhere completely different, right? Or in Jane Austen, you might get a young heroine and an older man that she finally figures out is the right man for her, the right man to give her the kind of education that Cavell talks about. In romantic comedies from this era, the stars are the ones we remember, the ones where there are two big stars, and by the time you get to be a big star, you're getting older.
And even if you aren't actually old, you come across as mature, and that's what Hollywood was doing during this period, which makes it actually all the more interesting that if you think about the Marx Brothers movies, they always had this ingenue and juvenile character in them for satirical purposes for the most part. But what are they satirizing? Not Hollywood movies. I guess Broadway plays of the 20s is what they're making fun of, because the romantic comedies don't have these kinds of characters.
Well, unless you get really weird versions of them, like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, who are way too old to be playing these characters.
Well, Ginger is not, really. I mean, but she comes across as mature.
She ain't 19.
No, but she's, what, like 22 or 23? And
is she really that young?
In Gay Divorcee, for sure. But she just comes across as 30 always, I think.
Well, I guess that's true, and I guess that speaks to what you were saying. A star role can't be written like an ingenue role.
No.
The actress has got to be sophisticated, and it has got to be a substantial role. And that's actually more like the Restoration comedy, the comedy of Congreve or Sheridan. But Cavell doesn't want to think about these movies in those terms because he thinks of them as being more romantic, capital R romantic, and he's probably right about that because they are American films. These movies all have, I would say, expressed in very different ways, some kind of American romantic vision. Although, it's interesting, therefore, to contemplate. We're now straying away from the topic of remarriage and going all over the place, but to contemplate, I was thinking when we were watching The Awful Truth, how absolutely viciously opposed that movie is to the corny Capra romanticization of the small town and the Midwest.
We could talk about that a little bit here, but we'll have to circle back on it. It's almost 100%. Certainly audiences at the time would have remembered Mr. Deeds Goes to Town the year prior to The Awful Truth, where Gary Cooper reads a poem to Gene Arthur.
Right.
That moment is replicated in The Awful Truth, but it's Ralph Bellamy, and it's supposed to be absolutely moronic. You could read it as McCarey saying, Capra, you've lost it. You've lost the plot. You invented this genre with It Happened One Night, and now you're doing this instead. Now, we've talked about those Capra movies to some extent. I think they have incredible aspects to them, but what you can say for sure is that they don't fit with romantic comedy the way Cavell or Kendall understands them all that well anymore.
Don't you think that Gene Arthur and Gary Cooper from Mr. Deeds, aren't they in their way having a philosophical conversation about their relationship?
She acknowledges in her own book that it's a radical change from what Capra had been doing with Stanwyck and in It Happened One Night, when he starts focusing on these guys. But Gene Arthur's so great in that movie that she just has to talk about her anyway. But the male figure in that movie is problematic. You've talked about that a lot. In McCarey, he becomes Ralph Bellamy.
Yeah, but I think the movie The Awful Truth actually redeems itself from the ultra-sophisticated position it adopts, and that's why I think Cavell's essay on the movie is his best essay in the book.
Of course it is.
But let's leave it. Let's leave it till we get there. Is there any other movie that actually has remarriage in it, such as Howard Hawks's 20th Century, that you would like to argue with Cavell should be included here? Probably not that one, even though it's really funny. I don't think it fits.
No, I don't think it fits. Function of remarriage in the movies is whether there's actual remarriage marriage or not. It is a reappraisal from a point of mature reflection that reaffirms all of the romance that has come before and deepens it. That's the idea.
And that's the Nietzschean eternal return that he talks about in the Awful Truth essay again.
It's funny that you use the eternal recurrence, because one thing, I wanted to look this up, but I ran out of time. Wanted to know if Cavell, I mean, he lived a long, long life and only left us 4 or 5 years ago, I think. Presumably, he had a chance to see Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, which is an amazing sort of sci-fi version of A Comedy of Remarriage. I would have loved to have read his reaction to that, because it does fit. It has just about everything you want.
He died in 2018. I guess my problem with that would be...
I mean, they even regressed to childhood literally.
My issue with that would be to say, and this is something we talked about when we did the movie, which I don't love as much as everybody else does, but you did bring me around on it a bit, that the movie is entirely about the man. But the interesting conversation we managed to have about it, because that was during our time travel iteration of the podcast, was, is this fantasy or memory, or what is this? What is this thing in his brain that is Kate Winslet, and is she him, or is she Kate Winslet, or is she something else altogether?
Yeah, she's a very important figure in the movie, and whether she's real or not, she is an equal partner, I think, in what happens in the movie. You know, one I often wondered why it didn't fit in, just because it's one of my absolute favorite romantic comedies of the period, is Holiday. But that's one that really is about Cary Grant, and I think that's why he doesn't have it in here.
He explicitly rejects it.
Yeah.
So we actually saw a little interview with Stanley Cavell on YouTube prior to doing this episode. A couple of things he mentioned there. One of them you just reminded me of was, can movies like this still be made? Even though I, Stanley Cavell, said that it required women of this particular generation who were the daughters of suffragettes. Despite my having said that, could movies like this still be made now? Are they being made? Well, it seems to me that one problem with that, with movies of this kind being made after this period, or not being revived after this cycle came to an end, the whole 30s romantic comedy slash screwball cycle, certainly after the 1970s, and I think we'll bring this up again when we talk about Adam's Rib, talk about it in more detail, but certainly after the 1970s, the idea that certain gains had been made for women, the ending of a conversation about feminism in the culture, and I'm not talking about the conversation that's had about feminism on Twitter, the fact that it became accepted in movies that women were the equal of men meant that this struggle for equality couldn't be depicted in the same way. And that insight of yours that I already brought up, that what's most interesting about a relationship, if what you want to do is make a movie that's about having a relationship, that's what the movie's about, is this struggle for equality and mutual acknowledgement within it. So if that's just accepted, if there's no excuse in the culture to talk about it anymore, then maybe movies like this won't get made anymore. So that's one thing I've thought about when thinking about that question. He also talks about, and did you see when that interview was from?
2002.
That's interesting. So in our old lives of being nearly 50, that's not so long ago, he says he still doesn't find that the conversations about film in the culture are at the level that he would like them to be. And he's talking specifically about things like newspaper reviews and short reviews.
Hopefully he wasn't talking about the blog I was doing at the time.
I don't know if he's talking about Siskel and Ebert. I don't know what he's talking about exactly. But he's not satisfied, and I can understand this, with the level of conversation that's going on about film. And so he specifically says in the intro that for him, not only is marriage about a certain kind of conversation, a certain quality of conversation, but criticism is also about a certain quality of conversation, that even if he's writing an essay, he feels like he is engaged in conversation with the reader, you know, with other critics, with the film. And if anything, conversation about all aspects of culture has gone rapidly downhill since this book was written. But I do think that it's interesting that podcasting is a medium in which conversation can thrive. It is often a conversation between two people, or between, you know, an interviewer and an interviewee. But I particularly like the form of the podcast that is two people, two friends, two partners who are engaged in an intellectual adventure together.
We are living the comedy of remarriage.
I hope so.
Before we get into the films themselves, I did have a couple more ideas about Latter-day comedy of remarriage possibilities. Some of Cassavetes' work, Minnie and Moskowitz. It's not a remarriage, of course. But it certainly is a prolonged negotiation between a man and a woman about how they should be together, and it does entail a recommitment.
Well, it seems to be a reversal of bringing up baby, in which it's the woman who doesn't think she's having any fun, and on some level really isn't. Like, something really excruciating is happening. The idea of the movie as bringing up baby, except this is done in Cassavetes'
brutalist style.
yeah, much more visceral, updated style that still has something comic and alive inside of it. The idea is that this is what it takes to break this woman out of her isolation, and we can see what happens to that Gina Rowland's character in other Cassavetes films where nothing can reach her. But this is the happy ending movie where something does, even though she really doesn't want it to.
No! I'm just trying to imagine Katharine Hepburn yelling, "You want me to hurt me?"
She gets Cary Grant. She gets pretty angry in Adam's Rib.
Oh, well, yeah, but I'm talking about the bringing up baby. Another one that I think actually fits in an interesting way is another time travel movie, Peggy Sue Got Married.
Yeah, I think that would actually fit. Like, when did Coppola make that? Was someone actually influenced by this book when they made that?
That's from 1986. I'm sure Coppola read it.
Yeah, that would definitely fit. Like, interestingly, though, based on what we were just saying about why are movies like this not being made anymore, that is also a movie like Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind that takes place entirely inside the woman, although Nicolas Cage is giving a very lively performance inside the woman.
He's there at the end, at her recovery bed.
And he is definitely not the right age for the comedy of remarriage in this movie, but he's doing just as well as Ginger Rogers for seeming older than he is.
In an ideal world, we'd just talk about all seven movies that have chapters in this book, but that would be a very long podcast that we just can't do.
Well, we used to do it all the time. I'm not sure how many people enjoyed that, though. Like all the Back to the Futures.
Well, that's only three.
Yeah, I know. It was a darned long podcast, though.
Well, that's true. If you search our podcast episode list, you will find discussions already on It Happened One Night and The Lady Eve. The others are certainly coming if we don't get to them today, but we will be zeroing in on The Awful Truth, His Girl Friday, and Adam's Rib. So we'll go chronologically. We'll start with The Awful Truth. Let's hear what Leonard Maltin has to say, just for a little contrast from Stanley Cavell and his...
Do you think Maltin's going to talk about Kant?
He probably won't. He gives The Awful Truth 3.5 stars out of 4, which right there, he's wrong. Hilarious screwball comedy. Carrie and Irene divorce, she to marry Hayseed Bellamy, he to wed aristocratic Molly Lamont. Each does their best to spoil the other's plans. McCarey won an Oscar for his inspired direction. The screenplay was by Vina Del Mar, based on a play by Arthur Richman, previously filmed in 1925 and 1929, remade in 1953 as the musical Let's Do It Again. Our cast list: Irene Dunne, Cary Grant, Ralph Bellamy, Cecil Cunningham, Mary Forbes, Alex Darcy, Joyce Compton. And the director, Leo McCarey.
I feel like maybe this is part of what Cavell was talking about when he said that public conversation about film is not everything that he would ideally like it to be.
Now, Leonard Maltin can get much more thoughtful than this in long-form essays and discussions, but he's never going to bring in Kant.
And of course, he has also used the trust that the average moviegoer, which used to exist and probably doesn't anymore, trust that the average moviegoer put in him to expose some of the great old classics, such as The Lady Eve. I remember he was a big proponent of that one.
Oh yeah, Leonard Maltin is one of the good guys. Every time I see it, I like it more, and I've seen it probably 50 times.
Well, of all of these movies, I'm sure I've seen His Girl Friday the most. I can't even guess how many times I've seen it. Definitely not 50. 20? And I've probably seen The Awful Truth. Again, I can't even guess, but less than that. It took me a while to appreciate it, for sure, because its structure is hidden, which is part of what Cavell talks about in the essay. Oh, and of course, Adam's Rib. This is probably only the third time I've seen it. One thing we should say about The Awful Truth is that, like It Happened One Night, this was an enormously influential movie. It was a huge, huge hit. There's no doubt that... I mean, some of the things that Cavell ventures here very cautiously about inter-film influence. At this point, there's no doubt that Hawks, for example, was influenced by this film in both His Girl Friday and Bringing Up Baby. Like, sometimes Cavell seems to be overreading, but sometimes he seems to be worried that he's overreading when he's stating things that now, when there's so much more film scholarship, we know so much more about circumstances of the making of the movies that many of these things are now taken for granted, the influence that the directors had on each other at the time.
And we have so much more access to the films themselves as well. I mean, Cavell probably had to go to a special vault to see these movies in the 70s when he was trying to rewatch them to discuss them with any degree of accuracy.
Yeah, and make notes. I did notice that there's a line he quotes from His Girl Friday that's better than the line that's actually in the movie.
One of the things that's so incredible about The Awful Truth is that it's so epistemologically nebulous. We never find out what Cary Grant was up to at the beginning of the film.
It was making me think about Sontag's Against Interpretation essay, which we're going to do, because just as much as in Persona, as she argues in that essay, I don't think the movie has an answer to the question of whether they cheated, or it changes its mind about it. It has multiple answers. I don't think it knows or wants you to know.
No, it's undecidable, which is amazing. They both could have cheated, neither of them could have cheated, and ultimately it doesn't matter because there was a disconnect between them. There was something that was going wrong with their marriage one way or the other, and they needed to reach a new stage. And the fact that they will never know what actually happened, and we will never know, is really an amazing feature of the film. Particularly in Cary Grant's case, another movie would have had a scene where it's all revealed that it was some kind of innocent lark that he was on, right? So that you get back on his side, you stop thinking about him as an adulterer. And this movie does not do that. And by not doing that, it seems to be breaking all kinds of rules Hollywood had about its protagonists at the time.
Is that, in fact, a unique feature? Like, does adultery come up in any of these other movies or any of the movies we can think of that have the remarriage feature in them?
It's so much more pointed in this one than anything else.
Can you think of any major romantic comedy where adultery is a question? I'm obviously not talking about a late black comedy like Unfaithful Yours.
Rex Harrison does recommit himself to the marriage, but not in a Stanley Cavell way.
You know, Miracle of Morgan's Creek is actually more of a comedy of remarriage than The Lady Eve, except that I think the way Cavell defines the genre, you can't think of Betty Hutton and Eddie Bracken as being the figures from this genre.
They're just not Cavell types, but that's too bad because they actually do have some really in-depth conversations.
What he has to forgive by the end of the movie is that she's had sex with possibly a lot of men and definitely one, and he's going to raise that man's children, and I mean, that's a lot to overcome.
Yeah, ratsky watsky. Yeah, in the Philadelphia story, Cary Grant is a drunk and a wife beater, but he's not an adulterer, as far as we know.
True.
And most of the time, the breakups happen due to some other kind of misunderstanding. His Girl Friday, I guess you could throw adultery into Walter Byrne's list of sins, but he seems too focused on the paper to be bothering with that.
Well, but also, if it ever happened, it's clearly not anything that bothered her. She does give her list of things that bothered her, and it's not on it.
No, exactly. So yeah, this one does stand out for that. The only other movie that's related in any way that has some of these aspects to it is still very different. My Favorite Wife, certainly a lot of jealousy involved there. It's due to circumstances of a separation of 7 years, and Cary Grant wondering about what Irene Dunne was up to on a desert island.
Right, and McCarey was supposed to direct that.
Yeah, so we start out with Cary Grant fixing up a fake tan in order to camouflage the fact that either he went to Florida and spent the whole time indoors with some paramour, or he never went anywhere and he just stayed at the club and played cards, or just communed with himself. We have no idea what he was doing, but we know that he's got to come up with a good story. It's not really even for his wife for the most part. It's for their whole entourage, and we're set in a world of conspicuous wealth, which is very important, and Cavell does acknowledge that you can't really, for the most part, have these kinds of narratives if economic hardship is part of the mix.
They just have to have leisure time.
Yeah, that's the key.
That is relaxing. I mean, we are anything but rich, but we do manage to do this podcast once a week.
But these people have way more time than that. They don't seem to do anything, right, for jobs. They own coal mines, they own other stuff.
Well, I'm saying that there has to be the leisure time to enjoy your life. You can't be just preoccupied by poverty or hardship or child raising.
Or work, right?
Well, and that's where maybe Adam's rib gets a little bit unbelievable, but
if the person does have a job, it's got to be one of these flexible jobs, which continues to this day in romantic comedies. It's a frequently mocked point that people in romantic comedies have these unrealistic jobs, these jobs that most people don't have, that allow them to just do whatever they want at any time of the day and pursue their romantic hijinks. When Harry Met Sally, I mean, they have jobs, we know what they are, but they never come up, they never see either of them really doing anything except hanging out with their friends and going on dates.
Well, that's an interesting movie to talk about in relation to the genre, because they are old. Well, I guess they're not supposed to be older when they originally meet, but we cover a lot of time. So yes, they're an older pair, I guess. Are they in their late 20s, these actors in this movie?
The actors?
Yeah.
No, Billy Crystal was like 41.
But Meg Ryan's probably like 28 or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And they're supposed to be contemporaries, and you just go with it because it's a great movie.
Yeah, and because of sexism.
Yeah.
And they're certainly having philosophical conversations about gender difference.
You could easily see When Harry Met Sally fitting into, there's no remarriage, but there are enough compensating elements that it could be a chapter in a Cavell book if he had wanted it to be.
He certainly has to make his claim.
He does, on New Year's Eve. Let's talk about the man having to make his claim, because I think it's about overcoming the sexist prerogatives that men have abused in the social context that these movies are made in, right? Where they feel like they're entitled to the woman's love without doing anything marvelous to really express how much they want to keep having a conversation with her.
I guess you could say that, although I also think of it in terms of the man having to make the move that initiates the romance, or in this case, the re-romance.
But that's not necessarily true, because the women in most of these movies, we're more with them than we are with the man in terms of our psychological insight. We have a better sense of how she feels in most of these movies. In The Awful Truth, we know the moment when Irene Dunn recommits to the marriage, and we follow her attempts to get past it, and we understand why she wants to, because he's really pissed her off, and it makes sense that she might be through with him. And we follow the whole process of her going through this rebound romance, finally realizing that that's not going to do it for her. And so she acknowledges to us, right, and to her aunt Patsy, that that's what's going on. And Cary Grant has to do it to her. He has to make the declaration to her, because he's been a lot more reticent, which is part of the gender role that the movies are trying to,
if you mean emotionally reticent, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that, and I think that's what Cavell is talking about. I never found that to be a particularly huge problem with his analysis, because it does fit with the cultural milieu that he's trying to examine. And these new women, they're in a struggle with themselves to throw off some of the constraints that society has put upon them and take ownership of the freedom that they begun to feel that they are entitled to, and they, of course, they are. What the men have to do, they've already got all of the freedom they can possibly use because of who they are, white men of at least middle-class background in all of the movies. What they need to learn is to actually tell the woman how they feel about her.
Of course, it doesn't actually happen in His Girl Friday.
No, and that's why His Girl Friday is a really fucked up choice.
Even though it is the other movie, along with The Awful Truth, that actually has remarriage in it. I guess Adam's Rib does eventually get to the brink of divorce as well. So does The Lady Eve.
Well, but and Philadelphia Story has a remarriage.
True. Yeah, there are a few. It depends whether the divorce comes before the movie or late in the movie, I guess. That's one way to differentiate them.
One thing that Cavell talks about a lot is the green world, where the couple must go to gain new insight or new perspective on their romance and recommit to it generally. And of course, again, The Awful Truth has the paradigmatic example of the of Aunt Patsy's cottage in Connecticut. And he even calls the green world Connecticut.
Yeah, and I think the movie invents that insofar as the other movies reference Connecticut.
Yeah.
This is the movie that invents that. And this was not in the play.
Really doubt that play has anything to do with this movie.
No, I managed to look up a plot summary of it, of somebody who had found this play in some archive and had revived it and put the summary on the internet, because it's not exactly an often performed play, and no, it doesn't have a lot to do with the movie. I was saying about this movie that, despite the fact that you could argue that all these movies have some kind of American romantic vision behind them, I think they're all, probably even It Happened One Night, aggressively urbanite. But certainly The Awful Truth is.
Oh, yeah. yeah, very much looking down on the baskets of deplorables.
It's not, you know, the world of nightclubs to which the Lords, Philadelphia story, adhere. That's when you're turning to trash, like Tracy Lord's father, right? When you're going to seed. But if not urbanite, then some form of sophistication.
Oh, absolutely.
They are pro-sophistication. Anyone who cannot live up to that culturally, whether it's Ralph Bellamy or Henry Fonda, is going to be the butt of a lot of humor.
But of course, it's also important that it's not a European version of sophistication, and that's how Cary Grant gets razzed about his being out of his continental mind in this movie. So it's a very particularly American brand of sophistication.
Right, so that brings us back to the epistemological undecidability of the infidelity in this movie, because that's something interesting that Cavell talks about, how this is an American version of farce, where in the European version of farce, adultery, actual adultery, is a laughing matter, because divorce is not considered a moral, legal option. In the American movie, it is, but adultery is not.
If the marriage isn't working, you're supposed to be a good Protestant and get divorced.
And of course, he specifically invokes Milton in this book.
Yeah.
Milton, you cannot have Cavell's idea of marriage if you don't have Milton's idea of divorce. The morality, the ethics of divorce are the precondition for the ethics of marriage. It has to be voluntary. It has to be democratic. What is the sexual problem that arises for the couple because of that? Well, the sexual problem is that they can't fulfill their sexuality outside of marriage. They've got to fulfill it within marriage and this particular idea of marriage, and that's going to be a problem, and that is the problem that Cavell convincingly, to me, says that this movie is working out and trying to solve.
I think it's really essential to zero in on this aspect of divorce making the relationship between romantic partners more exalted, because you can leave the marriage if you want to. And so if you stick with it, it's a daily reaffirmation, or that's the ideal version of it. Anyway,
you don't stick with it because it's a legal or moral or religious necessity, and you don't stick with it because you're doing it for the children.
Cavell is emphasizing, by calling these movies the comedies of remarriage, the idea that there is such a thing as remarriage amplifies the romance. And certainly we see that in this movie, because we have the screwball couple and we have this backstory. We're told about it in their court proceedings. They tell their origin story to the judge. It's a meet cute at a pet store. They both wanted to get Mr. Smith. Since they had this mutual interest in the dog, they wound up getting to know each other and getting married shortly thereafter.
But Cavell kind of makes fun of this and says that that's not a good reason to get married, because you want to give a home to a dog. So they've still got some thinking to do about why they got married in the first place and why they want to stay married.
Yeah, absolutely. They had this whimsical, breezy, romantic comedy meeting and initial courtship, and that sustained them for a few years. But at this point, that's wearing off, and they need to recommit at a more mature level or go their separate ways.
It's funny that you say a more mature level given what happens in this movie.
But that's the paradox of Cavell's analysis, right? They are reaching a greater level of maturity through a return to childhood. Nothing does that better than The Awful Truth. I mean, it goes from absolute madness with Irene Dunne turning this upper crust household on its head and challenging the police in various ways. Now, she's doing that from a position of privilege.
As Cavell points out, she's like ordering them around and then asking them what they want for Christmas.
Yeah, which you can't do unless you're as rich and as white as she is.
And the movie seems to realize that.
Yeah.
By the way, it's lampshading it, but at the same time, there's just an element of even the police being brought into the spirit of festivity.
Yeah, but it goes from all of that to the amazing final sequence in The Awful Truth, which I like more every time I see it, how they just go through these various tongue twisters about things being the same and different that have so many different meanings at once. It's not childlike in any way. Even though there are some silly aspects to it as well, like Cary Grant and Irene Dunne sort of wrangling with this interfering cat.
Doesn't Dunne specifically say at the beginning of this movie, in response to something, that Grant says, haha, you're a philosopher? At the beginning of the movie, in their first scene together, where difference and sameness comes up.
Yeah.
And it's specifically, the idea of philosophy is specifically raised. So the movie is explicitly thinking about this.
This final sequence, you could call it Wittgensteinian or Gertrude Stein, but it all has a very specific meaning. And
yeah, it's not nonsense.
No, absolutely not. And they are gradually coming to an understanding of the path that's led them. Clock is about to strike midnight on their marriage, and right at that moment, they reclaim it.
Yeah, and hopefully their sex, you know, for the sake of the Hays Code, their sex will be done in 30 seconds. But yeah, I mean, that is Cavell's idea of remarriage there, that things have got to be the same and also different. His whole line of argument here about what has to get solved between them and their marriage has to do with something that, like the sexual content of bringing up baby, I thought he was completely insane for the first time I read this essay. But that does kind of convince me as a possible reading of the movie. Which is, why does Irene Dunne have to impersonate his sister? The idea being that because this idea of marriage, this Protestant conversational idea of marriage, has this sibling-like element to it, and this idea of being children together and having a past together, having a history together.
Not as dog parents, but as youthful adventurers.
Although that's something that's desirable in the marriage, it nevertheless presents an erotic problem for them. How do we have carnal excitement in our marriage when we're siblings? Without going the incest route, because that's creepy.
Yeah, it doesn't work out so well in Pierre.
And the route that this takes, well, he thinks that Dunne solves that in the sort of almost act two of the movie. I'm not sure if they're balanced in terms of time, but it feels like the second act of the movie, because the whole problem of the first part of the movie, this farce involving Ralph Bellamy and her voice instructor, is solved, and she decides, okay, now I want to get Jerry back, but now he's dating this heiress. So this is a whole new problem for the movie to solve. It's like a new movie.
Yeah.
But it's the same movie because it's still working out this sexual problem of the couple.
We're really zeroing in on his jealousy issues and peevishness about this possibility that she could have ever had relations with another man.
Right, because regardless of whether he committed adultery or not, he acknowledges by the end of the movie that his sexual suspicion is the problem, which is the same as My Favorite Wife.
Yeah, absolutely. They're very related films.
And that makes it Shakespearean, but Shakespearean in terms of, well, certainly The Winter's Tale, which Cavell specifically brings up, but also in terms of the tragedies, which Cavell talks about in a lot in his book about Shakespeare, his collection of Shakespeare essays called Disowning Knowledge, which relates male sexual jealousy and suspicion to epistemological skepticism. So the awful truth is what this man wants and doesn't want to know. And it's almost as awful to know that he's been wrong as to know that suspicions are correct somehow. For one thing, if he's wrong, then he's crazy.
Yeah, and he certainly seems crazy when he barges into the recital.
No, but the absolute hilarity of this spontaneous invention of American farce, where the joke every single time is that everything looks suspicious when it's in fact innocent. Like, that seems like a joke about America, about American Puritans or something.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, isn't that Young Goodman Brown?
Well, Young Goodman Brown is kind of the reverse.
But he is crazy. Isn't that a story about Puritan insanity?
And the fact that no one can live up to the standards of virtue.
But in this romantic comedy version of that, the fact is that nothing is ever going on. It just looks like it.
Yeah. And I do think Alexandre Darcy is great in his role. Monsieur Duval.
Yeah, he's doing the most, as in the best, Astaire and Rogers movies. I just marvel at the most basic farce skills that people can bring to these movies. Nothing fancy is going on here. He's just delivering sort of funny lines and kind of funny ways, and every now and then people are laughing at how not funny the jokes are. And like lampshading how not funny the jokes are, and that's funny, and you know.
And of course he is there as a representative of the French boudoir farce.
Yeah.
Which he is very familiar with, and he's like, oh, I'm not going out there, no.
The ledge or the balcony that he's sure to fall off of, because that's what happens in these plays or movies or whatever.
I mean, everyone is perfect in this movie. Ralph Bellamy does a great job.
The mother is so good in her awfulness.
Well, Esther Dale, we've seen her in many different kinds of roles. role. She's always impressive.
The way she keeps laughing her way through pretend innocently delivering this story about Irene Dunne in front of Ralph Bellamy.
Yeah. Instead of her divorcing him, it should have been, and she just does like this little hand crossover.
Yeah, and then giggles.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, brilliant.
Joyce Compton, amazing in her one scene role.
Gone with the Wind.
You know, she's not a fool, and neither is Ralph Bellamy.
I was very struck this time by how nice Irene Dunne is to her.
Yeah.
When they meet, and how they do have this conversation where Dunne recognizes that she's not a fool. And I almost wonder, like, I don't know what the movie's intentions here are, but a lot of this, and you can say the same thing for some George Stevens and some Sturges, the way these directors treat comedy, a lot of this is what we would now call cringe comedy, but with more physical comedy than we're used to from that genre. Because I don't know how much we are supposed to share. I think we're supposed to share the embarrassment of Dunne and Bellamy and Grant watching Dixie Belle's vulgar performance, but I think it's also supposed to double back on us, and we are also embarrassed by their embarrassment, because they kind of are being
snobs
and sticks in the mud. And then again, when Ralph Bellamy is just trying to have some fun and jitterbug with Irene Dunne, and she's, because she is a type of woman, of society woman, who doesn't like being conspicuous, that doesn't mean there's anything wrong with him wanting to dance boisterously.
No, he's a good dancer.
Yeah, right? Of course, the movie then acknowledges that when Irene Dunne has to incorporate Dixie Belle into her own persona in order to show up these snobs and reestablish this carnal and yet familiar bond with Cary Grant.
Yeah, that's where our love team comes back to earth, right? And they reject this world of Barbara Vance and polo games and all that nonsense, and they seem closer to us and closer to Dixie Belle than to those people.
So in both cases, they have gone to extremes that are beyond what they actually want in their lives.
Yeah, and I think they have learned that they've been associating with a very superficial set of people that have probably not helped them to develop as human beings either, right? That crowd at the beginning, they're all gross.
And Patsy seems okay.
Yeah, and Patsy's great, but everyone else, they're just, you know, the worst kind of caricatures of upper crust monsters that Capra would have Gary Cooper punch out.
Right, and they're just, like, poking at our protagonists for their entertainment to see them fight over their infidelities.
So there you do see that it's not so far from the Capra vision as it might seem at other times. But one thing that McCarey does want to pull away from is this Hallmark card version of romance that Capra is kind of pushing at certain points, trying to get close to the, you know, the common man. Honestly, Mr. Deeds Goes to Town is the only time he goes maybe too far with that.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think what that movie is trying to achieve, there's no way not to go too far.
Yeah, and I mean, this was a movie Capra made after having a complete nervous breakdown and trying to find some way to reconnect with the American public on a different level, a messianic level.
I think one of the things that we said when we were talking about Mr. Deeds, like, maybe a legitimate source of objection to it is to say that Capra is pretending to be less sophisticated than he is.
Well, of course he is.
And you can't pretend, and this is something Irene Dunne has to learn when Cary Grant is poking her in the ribs with the pencil when she's listening to this stupid poem. These people can't pretend to be something that they're not, that they're less sophisticated than they are. There's nothing wrong, as Cavell says, taking a lesson versus not taking a lesson, the American way versus the European way. There's nothing wrong with being sophisticated, as there's nothing wrong with being unsophisticated.
Right. Yeah. It's when you try to move between those in a kind of inauthentic way that you get into trouble. And of course, Mr. Deeds Goes to Town is redeemed in innumerable ways. But one thing that doesn't really work with it, even though I love the movie, is the romance. Of course, you objected to it strongly.
Yeah.
And I don't feel like it's a very successful romance either. You could see why Cavell really has nothing to do with Frank Capra after It Happened One Night.
Yeah, I'm not sure that there's any more relationships that have within them a struggle for equality and acknowledgement in Capra. Just certainly to some degree, It's a Wonderful Life, but it's not, the movie isn't focused on that.
No.
But the relationship is very important, very intense, until they have children. And then it becomes about her defending the children against him, and him resenting the children.
Yeah, this is not fodder for Comedy of Remarriage.
Anything more you want to add about this one?
Well, we could probably talk about it forever, but we shouldn't. Let's move on to His Girl Friday. Leonard Maltin gives the movie 4 stars out of a possible 4.
So he thinks this is better than The Awful Truth.
Evidently. Splendid comedy remake of The Front Page, with Grant as conniving editor, Russell as star reporter and his ex-wife, Bellamy as mama's boy she's trying to marry amid hot murder story. Terrific character actors add sparkle in must-see film, scripted by Ben Hecht and Charles Lederer, remade with the same gender twist in 1988 as Switching Channels. Director Howard Hawks, of course, and the cast: Cary Grant, Rosalind Russell, Ralph Bellamy, Gene Lockhart, Helen Mack, Ernest Truex, Clarence Kolb, Porter Hall, Roscoe Carnes, Abner Biberman, Cliff Edwards, John Quaylen, Frank Jenks, and Billy Gilbert. That is a long cast list.
So you and I have gotten into some loud fights on the street over this movie. Back in the day. Back in the day when we were doing more street brawling. Because you think it's not as good as The Front Page. How did you feel about it this time?
I'm not saying it's not as good. I'm saying...
Well, you don't like it as much.
I object to things that are in it that are a distortion of the mission of The Front Page, let's say.
Can't they both exist?
Of course they can, and I gave it 5 stars on Letterboxd. It is an objectively great film, there's no question.
On this viewing, I felt like, for 3/4 of the film, I felt like this is Howard Hawks' best film. Well, certainly between this and Bringing Up Baby. It drags a little, the final sequence drags a little, I think because it's confining itself to the one set and following the play probably more closely than it does for the rest of the movie, and it's not that that's bad, it's just that we're not used to that in a cinematic context, but it is so amazing in the way that it volleys between tones, between the silliest comedy and the darkest cynicism and the deepest pathos, and I mean one second after another. The tonal mastery is mind-boggling.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue with any of that. I mean, Helen Mack's performance is extraordinary.
As Molly Malloy?
Yeah.
Yeah, and what she accomplishes with the other actors in that scene, with Rosalind Russell and all of the newsmen. Like, the whole ensemble is on fire, and Hawks' direction of them is so precise and yet so casual. And people who've listened to this podcast, I've criticized Hawks' writing and direction plenty of times. In fact, that scene is the only time that his hysterical woman character or scene, well, those 2 scenes with Molly Malloy, it's the only time that that idea works, and it's because he split his heroine character into 2.
Yes, but let's not forget that that is direct from The Front Page and...
Yeah, but he brings it within the range of his concerns.
Lewis Milestone also does an amazing job with that scene, and it's Mae Clark playing her in the original film. I mean, it's just an amazing scene.
Sure, but what this particular movie is doing with it is, of course, very different because of the addition of the Hildy character.
Yes,
and what
that's
the
true.
Scene means from her perspective and what the movie is trying to tell us about her.
And John Quaylen is also extraordinary. I mean, he's a great character actor. He's in almost every John Ford movie. He's ubiquitous in the 30s and 40s, but as the little man fugitive, he is terrific. And that scene of the interview really is great. I mean, Rosalind Russell, you know, your mileage may vary with Rosalind Russell over the course of her career, but it certainly is the case that this is the part that she was born to play.
I've heard more than one person tell me that, because I saw this movie, I'd probably seen this movie 10 times before I saw any other Rosalind Russell movie. I had one person tell me at the time that they thought that this was the only role in which she shines.
I wouldn't say that.
She was used differently in this movie than she ever was again, and that's a shame, I would say, because she's funny and authoritative and sexy in this movie in a way that she really isn't as a character ever again.
Well, there's a movie called Take a Letter, Darling, which I think we are doing probably in about 2028.
Even in that one, she's presented as a problematic character. But of course, in not presenting this character as problematic, this movie is very unique.
Yeah, that's true.
I really feel like this movie, by bringing together The Front Page with Howard Hawks's ideal relationship, it makes them more than the sum of their parts.
Yeah, well, I think that's the only reason we wind up yelling at each other on the street, is because I believe that The Front Page is a great movie in its own right.
Well, you're talking about the version with...
with Adolph Malju and Pat O'Brien, directed by Lewis Milestone, who was a Marxist at the height of his left-wing commitments, you know, using it to really bludgeon American capitalism and American society, which is not what Hawks wants to do.
That's That's also not at all what Cavell is interested in.
No, of course not.
In this movie. So how is this movie a Hawks movie? And then can a Hawks movie of that kind be the comedy of remarriage that Cavell wants it to be, I guess is the question. First of all, what does Cavell have to say specifically about this movie? Why does it, what makes it stand out from the others? Well, the fact that he does see it as a satirical, cynical, Johnsonian comedy rather than a romantic Shakespearean comedy. And he thinks there is no utopian vision in it.
There's no green world. Instead, there's a black world, which is pervasive. I mean, it's the entire movie. And there's no escape from it. There's Albany, but that would be even worse.
Yeah. Albany offers nothing in its own right. It just deprives you of whatever, basically of the pleasures of cynicism, which is the only pleasure that anyone can have in this movie. But it also, as we see with the press men, creates a hell for them.
Oh, yeah.
The reason this transformed Hildy Johnson character, this Hildy Johnson character transformed into the Hawks woman, the reason she's Hawks' most successful Hawks woman is that she is part of the professional world and outside of it. And this is something Molly Haskell gets very right, because I criticized her before on the podcast too. She gets very right about this movie. The character is both part of the professional world, which is not the case in Hawks's dramas, where he has a woman standing outside of it and criticizing it from the hysterical feminine point of view. But she also stands outside of it and can see past it. It's almost like her gender gives her the privilege to see past it and have a possibility of escape from it. But ultimately, as Cavell says, and I think this is his genius innovation in this essay, it's not that that wouldn't be happiness with her, it's that there is a higher form of happiness for her that doesn't look like happiness. That is what we see before our eyes. We actually see her demonstrate having that happiness before our eyes as we see her in action working in this movie.
Key scene is when the condemned man escapes. She recommits to the remarriage. For her is not to Walter, really, it's to her career.
Yeah, which of course Hawks loves.
Of course.
Well, but Walter is the same person as her career.
Yeah, there's no separation between them.
For either of them.
And of course she gets on the phone and says, I'm on the job, and then she does her flying tackle.
Even more key, maybe, is the scene where Bellamy actually comes to the criminal court building and is imploring her to come with him, and she's writing up the story, and she and Walter are clicking as a team again. That's when the words come out of her mouth, right? That can't you see that this is the most important? Which is actually the same, basically the same line as Katharine Hepburn delivers in Woman of the Year to Spencer Tracy, right? Can't you see that this is the most important thing in my life, or whatever? But here, that is her finding her true self in this fleeting moment of this thing that is unconsciously coming out of her mouth. And once she snaps back to herself, like, she's never going to be able to completely connect and completely find this happiness in a conscious way. Like, most of the time it will be unhappiness for her, but it doesn't matter, right? And of course the same line in Woman of the Year is villainous.
Yeah, such a strong contrast, the entire spirit of this film to all of the other works examined by Cavell in this book, because she's recommitting to her career, but her career is basically about being a viciously cynical child.
So you don't buy that there is anything to what Walter says, even though obviously it's not his motive, but you don't buy that there's anything to the power of the press and its ability to expose the truth about politicians, for example. Or for that matter, that she could be actually trying to help people in this movie in addition to trying to get the best story.
The whole context it's embedded in makes it clear that, you know, if you're looking at the world the way Howard Hawks does, what difference does it make if you get grafting politicians out of office? Because the next ones are going to be the same, and there's no actual political bone of contention. It's just controlling the spoils.
To Howard Hawks, what matters is you're good at your job and that gives you joy.
That has no relationship to anything else that Cavell is talking about in the book.
No.
And they do not emerge from their shared adventure, as exciting as it is, and putting one over on the government and saving John Quaylen from execution. Yes, Molly Malloy survives.
We don't know.
Yeah. But they don't have a new understanding of their relationship.
No, but what Cavell is talking about, what he says, I guess, takes the place of utopia in this movie, or takes the place of morals, since
there are none.
Since there are none, and certainly Walter Burns has none, is adventure and improvisation. So let's break this down a bit here. We've got Walter and his world, which are amoral and cynical.
I mean, his right-hand man is an out-and-out criminal.
Yeah. We've got Bruce and his mother, who represent sort of homely values that ultimately don't really stand for anything either.
I think it is, again, significant. Ralph Bellamy plays him fairly likably, open-minded. He comes in prepared to bat Cary Grant on the nose for his behavior, and he's like, he's actually a nice fella. Now, he's been fooled, which is not anything to his credit.
Yeah, and he doesn't want Hildy to quit her job if she doesn't want to. All he wants is for her to rate their relationship as more important than her job.
And I think that's not a completely unreasonable demand.
After what he's been through that day, probably not. Ultimately, they're not like a strong source of moral values either.
No.
There's no sense of aesthetic value like these aesthetic values of adventure and improvisation that we see enacted before us with a admirable beauty. Like, there's no other Hawks movie that shows you people working in a way that demonstrates the value of it, the aesthetic value of it, the way that he always wants to, I feel. Like, not even Only Angels Have Wings.
Well, that's the closest that he comes, other than this one, yeah.
The only moral center in the movie is Molly and Earl.
Yeah.
And their relationship. He's just a poor, pathetic loser, and she's just a girl. He's the only one who treats her kindly, and he inspires her kindness. How does she end up? She ends up sacrificing herself for him. So moral values exist in the movie, but they exist in individuals, and the individuals, they can't survive.
It was a brave decision of Hawks's to leave those characters in the movie the way they are in the front page, because he didn't have to. I mean, he could have changed it to reduce the pathos.
Well, but like I said, it's essential to the way that he is thinking of this choice that Hildy has to make. And we see it in the scene where the men in the press room are taunting Molly.
It's so brutal.
And she doesn't participate in it, but what she's doing is she's watching them, and she's feeling empathy for Molly, but at the same time, she's thinking of, because her life is her work, this is who she is, this is what she does, this is all she is. She's turning this into a story at the same time that she's watching and empathizing, and then once she's got her story, she escorts Molly out and tries to comfort her, which is more than the men have to offer her.
But she also knows why they're doing it, because they are required to shut off all of their empathic abilities.
Yes, and they know that, and we see them knowing that because Hildy has implicitly called them out on it.
Yeah.
Afterwards, in this long, silent sequence.
You know, if they were as amoral as they pretended to be, then they wouldn't be upset.
So this is the downside that Hawks shows of this profession. You know, the downside in Only Angels Have Wings is that they're all killing themselves for no reason, just because they're good at their jobs, or they have a job and they need to be good at it. And here the downside to the profession is this complete blanket cynicism and amorality that's necessary to survive and also to be good, like Walter's good at his job. The upside of it is that she is good at it, and that is the final word. And for him, for Hawks, this discovery of that, and the fact that she can't do anything to change it, and, you know, and the fact that that is good and bad. Like, this is what the whole movie is about.
Would have been disingenuous, I think, of the film in the way that Hawks has conceived it if they had made it clear that they've improved the world in any way. Because we know that they're not going to.
No, the only improvement here is part of the structure of comedy itself, which Cavell calls a reprieve, right? It is part of the structure of comedy to avoid tragedy. In this case, the hanging of the scapegoat.
Yeah.
So that is some kind of grace that the movie has to offer, but it's a vision of the universe, right? It's not a vision of this. No one who's done anything in this movie has done anything to improve this world. The universe just has grace in it because the genre happens to be comedy. Do we think that these two people are having a philosophical conversation about marriage or their relationship?
I mean, it doesn't feel like it. Unless you want to say that their particular slant on marriage, it goes beyond or goes beneath the exalted idea of marriage as carnal friendship, and it becomes marriage as carnal work relationship.
Which, I mean, I guess we didn't plan it this way, but that does make an interesting transition to Adam's rib.
Yeah.
Because when we see them, well, what's important, the bond between them, and I think Cary Grant in this performance, as vile as this character is, He certainly doesn't whitewash Walter Burns, but I think because it's Cary Grant, we believe, in a way that's much more true than in the Philadelphia story, where this is made explicit and Cavell actually seems to buy it, but it's much harder to buy for me. I think we believe that he, because he understands that her work is who she is, he understands her. And that is the source of their bond, and that is the most important thing to them both. But what the movie is working out is the fact that she has to come to an acceptance that she will never accept this, right? She will never accept who she is, and yet she can't stop being who she is. And that there is this adventurous, improvisational, professional joy in that as well. But when you stop and look at it morally, or even from the point of view of being a human being, as she says, because we can see how everyone else in the movie has been warped, then she will never be comfortable with that. Don't you think that's the most whole portrayal of a human being that ever appears in any Howard Hawks movie, given what he wants to do in his movies as an auteur?
Yeah, I think you're right about that. And certainly that is where the strong connection between this movie and the other six lies, in that it is so solidly focused on the woman's experience.
And this idea of a new woman,
yeah,
that Cavell talks about.
And I mean, Cary Grant, as funny as he is in this movie, obviously the whole point of him is that he doesn't develop in any way or think about anything in a new way.
And I think it is the movie that most, because nobody really does go through a change, not even Hildy Johnson. She has a kind of new perspective on her experience, but she hasn't changed except in her understanding of herself.
Well, she's changed in the fact that she knows that finding an insurance guy and moving to Albany is not going to help either. But there's no mutuality to it. So it's not like, well, it is sort of like The Lady Eve, but the other movies it's not like.
In The Awful Truth, they have to, and particularly he has to, but both of them in relation to each other have to change a little, be a little different so that things can be the same. Here, all that changes is that she understands that she won't change and accepts that insofar as it can be accepted. So I feel like this is actually the movie that maybe is the most like The Eternal Recurrence.
Probably, yeah.
In that she really is, it's almost like a time travel movie in that her life really is just about to repeat over again, except now with her new perspective that this is, for better or worse, what I actually want.
In a Nietzschean nightmare world of the will to headlines, Leonard Maltin gives Adam's Rib 4 stars out of 4.
Okay, what does he have against The Awful Truth? What's wrong with this guy?
Have to ask him. Smart, sophisticated comedy by Ruth Gordon and Garson Kanin about husband and wife lawyers on opposing sides of the same murder case. One of Hollywood's greatest comedies about the battle of the sexes, with peerless Tracy and Hepburn supported by movie newcomers Holiday, Ewell, Hagen, and Wayne. Cole Porter contributed the song Farewell Amanda. Remade in Bulgaria in 1956. In this version, the heroine rebels against tradition as a result of her conversion to Marxism-Leninism. Later a TV series. Also shown in computer-colored version. Director George Cukor. And the cast list. Spencer Tracy, Katherine Hepburn, Judy Holliday, Tom Ewell, David Wayne, Gene Hagen, Hope Emerson, Polly Moran, Marvin Kaplan, Paula Raymond, and Tommy Noonan.
So when you decided to add this to the movies we're going to do for this episode, I was very resistant because the last two times I watched this movie, or whatever, I think 2 times, hated it. And I know you're not, or weren't, I don't know how you feel now, that fond of it either. And I think it comes down to a phrase that Maltin used right there. I'm not too keen on any movie that is about the battle of the sexes. I mean, that's one problem right there with this ever being one of my favorite romantic comedies. However, this time I appreciated it a lot.
Yeah.
It will never be one of my favorites, but...
No, me neither. It's certainly a very good movie.
Yeah.
With a lot of interesting things going on, and some of them are totally incidental to what Cavell is examining. I mean, I think Judy Holliday gives a tremendous performance.
Yeah, I think most people agree with that.
I'm a big fan of Judy Holliday. I don't think you share my admiration.
Yes, but everybody disagrees with me, so that's fine. I do like her singing.
She's a great singer. That scene where she barges in and goes from being so hilarious that she's looking at the instruction booklet on how to shoot someone. I mean, it just becomes almost Cassavetes level of agony as you watch her pull the trigger and scream. Yeah. And
Cukor has a lot of different tones in this movie, and his tonal confidence is, as well as just how far the script will dig in terms of discomfort in some of the scenes, is greater than I remembered.
Well, that's a good basis upon which to begin. But we should focus on what Cavell is focused on, which is this relationship between the Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn characters. We've discussed them before. We did Woman of the Year not too long ago in MGM 1942.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say that in terms of examining, I will now say that in terms of examining the Battle of the Sexes, this movie is much better, much more egalitarian and interesting. Stevens really, really cops out in some scenes and in a way that we talked about at the time in Woman of the Year than that movie. As well as, I don't think I've thought before of how much Hepburn's persona from Woman of the Year is continuous in her other movies with Spencer Tracy, how still very much more sexual she is in this movie than she is in any movie before 1940. So what is Cavell focusing on in this movie?
He gets really into a discussion of gender roles in his chapter.
Is that what you were focused on? I think I was thinking more about, he goes a little nuts, almost to the point for me of incoherence, on this question of their private versus their public relationships. But in a way that actually did pay off in my viewing of the movie, in that she ultimately gets the public victory over him, but he, by using the same methods to which he objected to her using in the courtroom, gains the private acknowledgement from her that she does actually think he was right. I guess one of the reasons the movie seemed more interesting to me than on previous viewings when I was younger is I didn't remember that this question of who's right in what side they're choosing is pretty much insoluble.
It's sort of like in City on the Edge of Forever, Spock says, you know, Edith Keeler was right, but at the wrong time. In this movie, it's the reverse. Katharine Hepburn might be wrong in a way, but at the right time, because Judy Holliday shouldn't go to jail. When she's reunited with her kids, it's almost, for me, on the level of Isabella Rossellini being reunited with her child at the end of Blue Velvet.
Oh, I had like a completely opposite reaction.
Really?
Yeah, I was thinking about, well, Cavell does highlight the weirdness of the public framing, like the way the photographers are framing all the participants in the trial at the end, and the way that they're bringing in not only her and her children together, but also her and her husband, and he's kissing her, and then they want the mistress in there, Jean Hagen, who's looking really uncomfortable, and how this is similar to the weird polyamorous framing at the end of the Philadelphia Story, but like to a very different effect, and the effect it has, and I'm glad Cavell emphasizes, because I might have glossed over it otherwise in my viewing. The effect it has is to make you ask, where is this relationship? Where is her life going after this?
Oh, it's going to be terrible, of course, but I'm talking about the moment when the kids rush in, you know, before they get entrapped once again in this media framing, which is horrible.
And in this horrifying marriage.
Yeah, it's...
Or whatever is going to happen to it. Clearly they don't have a lot of money. What's a divorce going to look like for them?
Yeah, it's not going to be good, obviously.
I mean, those are questions that this movie actually raises. When you can't afford a divorce, you don't really have the option of remarriage, do you?
No.
Contrasting this couple, and Cavell also talks about this, a contrast between that couple, who are a kind of double to Adam and Amanda, Pinky and Pinky, in some other tawdry, melodramatic life, right, where they're not protected by their Olympian wealth as white professionals.
Yeah.
Which it also makes this a very particular kind of feminist movie. It sets the terms in which we still think of feminism in the movies or in media now, I think, which is white, neoliberal, rich people feminism. And it may look a little different in 1949, like it's obviously more radical in 1949, but the way that we think of, in media, women's equality doesn't look much different now, unfortunately, than it does in this movie. And I don't think the movie is completely unaware of the kind of privilege that these people have within the story. Aren't Ruth Gordon and Garson Kanin some kind of commies or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, and of course, as you say, Judy Holliday is facing a completely different feminist problem, which is how to exist in a marriage where you're getting batted around if you ask any questions of your husband who won't come home. What kinds of options are available to her? Well, none, really, except if she happens to get into the headlines for trying to shoot him. The fact that that's in this movie as well clearly throws the problems that Adam and Amanda have into stark relief.
Well, the difference is, as Cavell touches on in his essay, that Adam and Amanda can afford to have this civilized discussion, even if incivility does encroach upon it at moments, as it does in civilized life, this civilized philosophical discussion about gender and marriage and equality, and that is just not remotely available to Tom Yule and Judy Holliday.
No. Doris Attinger.
So how did you feel about it this time?
I've always liked the movie. It's only in contrast with the other six films that I think it winds up somewhat lacking.
Maybe the approach we should take is, why don't you like it as much? Like, is that the way into talking about how this does or does not belong in the genre for us?
I mean, it belongs in the genre. Why don't I feel like it's at the same level? I think this feels a little bit more dated in a way, even though, as you say, it does have qualities to it that leave it barely distinguishable from Hillary Clinton-style feminism today.
Right, and as a didactic feminist movie, we just watched Barbie, which we enjoyed, though not particularly for those qualities.
Yeah, well, I gave that 4 stars too, so well, they're probably about on the same level.
But you are a feminist, Dave, so what is just not like didacticism? You do like it when it's Marxist.
I'm never a big fan of explicitly battle of the sexes type narratives.
You love Harry and Sally, though, and they do nothing but talk about, or he does nothing but talk about how men and women are different.
Yeah, but the whole point of that movie is that that's just the surface level of conversation, and there really isn't that kind of difference between them that they think there is.
Yeah, but is there in this movie?
I think in this movie it's a little more ambiguous. It does try to get to some of that as well, and Spencer Tracy does turn things around in some interesting ways at the end. Some of it just comes down to, you know, I don't find all of it thrillingly hilarious like the other six movies, you know. David Wayne, I like that actor, and even in this movie, I enjoy him when he's commenting on the home movies, but a lot of the rest of the time, I'm like, oh, I hate this character. Make him stop singing Farewell, Amanda. I don't like that song.
He is supposed to be irritating.
I know, but it's still, you have to listen to it.
Does come back in an interesting way at the end when Spencer Tracy starts singing it. He adopts it. Well, that character clearly doesn't make any sense. He seems to exist just so that George Cukor can pee his pants laughing at an effeminate man who is clearly meant to be gay or at least bisexual, going on and on and on about how much he wants to have sex with women, and particularly Amanda. This movie was an enormous hit, though, so other people also enjoyed this.
Of course they did, sure. I mean, it's often seen as the greatest of the Tracy Hepburn movies. It's probably going to be this or Woman of the Year that people pick. I think my favorite is Without Love, which never gets picked.
So would you say that the problem is that because the movie makes the issue of equality explicit, that it doesn't make enough room for that to be dramatized in the unfolding of the relationship and in the play between the characters instead? Is that, would you say that's part of the problem?
Yeah, I think so. And it's just the kind of fun that they're having when they are having fun. The fact that, you know, we're watching the home movies, they just seem middle-aged, you know?
But they
which
are.
They are. But they're acting like they're middle-aged.
They're middle-aged wealthy professionals who have just paid off the mortgage on their home in Connecticut.
It's just not the kind of thing that's going to excite me, right? And even though the movie is poking fun at the ways in which they choose to lead their lives, it's still, that's all we see is them doing that or them doing their jobs. There's not a whole lot there to latch onto, and there's nothing comparable to the fun that you get from bringing a baby, let's say. Or It Happened One Night, exhilarating romance of those people either falling in love or reconnecting the way that you get in The Awful Truth.
I guess this is the only movie that he talks about where we actually see a marriage happening.
Well, that's true. And maybe that's not always the best thing.
Even though we do also follow them in their professional lives.
The green world, you know, we only glimpse it in these cheesy home movies, and in the final moments, they're going to go back to see the dogs and everything. But it's not dramatized the way it is in these other movies. So it's less replenished by that energy that is the entire purpose of Cavell's book to explore. So I think that's where it falls short for me in terms of all-time great status. But I thoroughly enjoyed watching it. nevertheless this time. And I had a feeling that we both would.
So what actually is the movie accomplishing then, if we did enjoy it, nevertheless?
Do you think it's never a bad thing to spend time with Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn, even if they are behaving exceedingly middle-age-ishly? I wouldn't turn down a chance to see any of their movies, right? Because they're both great actors.
I mean, I think it's important, yeah, to consider the fact that these are the oldest characters that we see in any of these movies.
It's a very different time period, really. Like, things changed quickly. Cavell is talking about movies from 1934 to 1941, and then this one from 1949. It just feels very different. It feels like we're not in the screwball era anymore. And because he's constructed his own microgenre that is not playing by any rules, he shoehorned this one in. Because it was obviously important to him. He was at the exact right age to see it. Maybe he saw it before the others, right? Because he was probably not old enough to see some of the early ones in the theater. So this could be the first of the movies that he saw. But yeah, it just doesn't fit with the other. Of course, that's part of the genius of his book, is that almost all of them, you could say, they don't fit for one reason or other. But this one doesn't fit because of the historical period in which it's made. But one thing that he does talk about a lot that I did want to ask you how you felt about was his sustained examination of the scene in which Hepburn asks the jurors to visualize the participants in this love triangle as the opposite gender. Because he does talk about that a lot.
Well, that comes off the back of her victory, the victory of her circus methods, literal circus methods, when this vaudeville circus acrobat woman lifts Spencer Tracy.
Yeah, Hope Emerson.
In the air. And that works. All of her tricks work on the jury. So to me, it's not as obvious as it is to him that this is failing. Watching it, I can't tell what the tone is. It again seems to be just Cukor being interested in gender and playing around with gender in a way that either he doesn't quite know what he's doing with the scene or I don't know what he's doing with it.
I wasn't impressed by Cavell's discussion of this stuff, but he does spend several pages on it, I think.
No, it just feels like that.
Okay, maybe.
He wants to go off on a tangent about it, but then he doesn't, so he never fully unpacks what it is he wants to say there. I think maybe he should have taken out that section and made another essay out of it. What he wants to talk about is his idea that the camera already feminizes men, so they don't need to be feminized. And I guess the camera only feminizes, but I mean, obviously that's highly debatable. Many have pointed out, particularly in this time period of studio era Hollywood, the great actresses that we remember, the great female stars, the Barbara Stanwycks, the Joan Crawfords, the Katharine Hepburns, the Betty Davises, all in their own way, not visually perhaps, but all in their own way could be said to possess a masculine quality that certainly isn't present in your average female star today. Part of their stardom is there's a terrifying assertiveness and anger that they possess, right? And or anger. And then there were other actresses of the era, female stars of the era who were in fact playing with gender on film, like Marlene Dietrich or Greta Garbo. So I don't know that you want to argue or can make much of an interesting argument about the camera feminizing, but anyway, he doesn't end up going into it.
I just found it very unprofitable. I wanted to see if you felt the same way, and I guess you did.
Well, yeah, like I couldn't even tell what the scene was doing in the movie, so I think it was unprofitable for Cukor and for Cavell.
It's at least integral to Katharine Hepburn's argument in the court, this idea of the double standard and thinking about what kinds of privileges are accorded to men that are not accorded to women. But then to use special effects, misguided thing. Let's just leave it at that. And it was probably misguided for Cavell to try to talk about it because he doesn't do a good job.
And honestly, it's probably misguided for us to talk about it and you should probably take it out of the episode.
No, I think it's got to stay. There are some really fun things about the relationship that are middle-aged things that we could probably relate to, like them calling each other Pinky with different spellings. I do like that, and it is really funny when it comes out in court, when the stenographer says, wait a minute, what was that? What did you call her?
I was surprised rewatching it that Hepburn is never flustered in court. Maybe this is, okay, a thread we could pull at to try to talk about what underlyingly the movie is doing with the relationship. That it's always Tracy who gets flustered in court and not her. He is the one who is having the problem here with the bringing together of their public and private worlds, which is what Cavell is talking about. He's the one who objects to it, and he's the one who has a problem keeping them separate when they're brought together, so to speak.
Yeah, and that's a result of his male privilege, as people would say, and I think that's true.
So do you mean then that the issue is that he can privately say to her that he agrees with her views on women's equality, but he doesn't want to put that to the test as the two of them fighting each other? He wants them to be, what, then, united, or he wants her to support him? Or what is it that he wants that this situation she's created is disturbing for him?
He just doesn't want to deal with the implications of it. He wants to say that he is on board with it, but all the while snickering at it, right? I mean, he gets in a lot of little jabs about how she's cute when she gets cozy and stuff like that. That's not unqualified support for her position, and he's clearly not treating it with the same level of seriousness that she is.
Yeah, and despite what Cavell says in this essay, he never fully, like, that's what the ending of the movie is about. She thinks there is no significant difference between men and women, and he thinks, I guess, that there is, although that shouldn't make them different under the law, or whatever. Which, of course, you know, that can be an argument. The two are not, as we talked about in our Lincoln episode, that can be an argument. The two are not equal, but should be treated equal under the law. That can be very sexist and racist.
Well, yeah, separate but equal is a buzzword for oppression in American history. I mean, that's the Supreme Court decision that upheld Jim Crow. You want to be careful about making statements like that. You know, that Vive la différence ending, it is again a heteronormative interpretation of romance, right? Which is that in order to have a great romance, which we've talked about in the past,
we have to have different genitals? Like, that's literally what's being said.
No, but what I'm saying is that what we agree with, I think, is that there has to be a sense of separation between the two, or otherness, in order for you to be fully in love with the other person. They can't feel like they're you. They have to feel like something exciting that is part of but not part of your life, so you can continually be refreshed by the encounter.
Well, yeah, then that's why I brought up the thing that you were saying to me in private, right? Which is that, because I think I've actually raised that argument as a devil's advocate in discussions about gender and relationships before, and I thought that was a correct comeback, right? To say that any two people are sufficiently different.
Yeah, exactly.
To create an epistemologically exciting relationship.
So the otherness doesn't have to come from gender. Of course it doesn't. But for Spencer Tracy and for this movie, at least on the surface, it's saying it's a great way to do it because it's got built-in otherness, so you can just worry about the other stuff. But no, you don't need it. You can have that with anyone. And of course, George Cukor knew that, the director, but that doesn't mean that he can make a movie that is defying heteronormative ideology in an explicit way.
Oh, sure. And there can also be different gender expression in homosexual relationships.
Well, that's true. We'll have to end our discussion there, but we'd love to hear what you think. Send us emails, get involved in our Discord. You can contact us in innumerable ways, and we're eager to hear. If you did pick up Stanley Cavell's book, what did you think of it?
I'm hoping that everyone who did had their mind set on fire like I did when I first read it.
Next week on the podcast, well, we're moving into a new actorist overview. It's our first visit with Lily Palmer. We'll get into a little of her backstory at that time, and watching Crime Unlimited from 1935 and The Great Barrier from 1937. I'm looking forward to that. I hope you are too.